And it's Philemon, and it is toward the end of the New Testament. It is between Titus and Hebrews, and I encourage you to open your Bible. And like last week, Jude, it only has 25 verses, but boy, it's good. I loved Jude, and I love Philemon. I'm going to read it for you, okay? This is Paul writing. And you know what? We call them Paul's letters, but this is really like Paul's postcard because it's short. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, to Apphia, our sister, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house. So apparently Philemon has a house church. He's a leader. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Philemon's love and faith. When I remember you in my prayers, I always thank my God because I hear of your love for all the saints and your faith towards the Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do for Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. There's a great love between Paul and Philemon. Philemon sounds like a very, very prominent, very good Christian man. For this reason, though, I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty. Yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love, and I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. Paul is imprisoned in Rome while he is writing this postcard. I am appealing to you for my child Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful both to you and to me. I am sending him, that is my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel, but I prefer to do nothing without your consent in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever. No longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother. Especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about your owing me even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident in your obedience, I am writing to you knowing that you will do even more than I say. One thing more, prepare a guest room for me, for I am hoping through your prayers to be restored to you. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends greetings to you. That was apparently the person that was in the cell with Paul while he was imprisoned in Rome. Paul just ministered to whoever was in the room with him. And so do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. So this is a personal letter, not a letter to a church like many other Paul's letters. And it's a letter to a very prominent person named Philemon. And we know that he has a slave. It was common practice for wealthy families in Rome in that time to have slaves. The slavery was not based upon race, but upon socioeconomic status. Slaves were usually very poor people who became slaves or indentured servants because of necessity. And so it appears that Onesimus has done something wrong and fled Philemon. Now, some of the commentaries said that he had stolen. Some said they weren't sure what he had done against Philemon, but what he did was pretty bad. And he fled. So somehow, in God's providence, this slave who has fled his master encounters Paul and becomes a believer. He encounters Paul, and Paul pretty much adopts him as a spiritual son. Paul was always doing that. That's how he related to Timothy, as a spiritual father. And he says here that this is he is part of my heart. I don't know how long the time had been, but it would obviously have been several months, maybe even a year or so, that they had been in relationship. And Onesimus was serving Paul as he was imprisoned. Now, in case you don't realize it, during this time, if you were imprisoned, you were dependent on your families to bring you food, or your loved ones or your friends to keep you fed and to bring you what you needed. A couple years ago, one of the Assemblies of God pastor close to where I live put a jail cell in the front yard of the church, and he stayed out there, had a cot, and was dependent on people to bring him food and what he needed. It was to raise emphasis about Christians that were imprisoned and being tortured around the world, and was to just put himself on the mercy of the church. I thought what he did was pretty phenomenal, to be that visual reminder. So Onesimus has been helping take care of Paul as he has been imprisoned. And so it has come to the point where Paul, you know, says, you know, Onesimus, it's time for you to go back to Philemon and face the music. I'm going to advocate for you. I'm going to write a letter. The great Paul is writing a letter on Onesimus's part. And it says, basically, I love you, Philemon. We're brothers in Christ. I'm sending Onesimus back to you. He is a different person. He has come to faith in Christ, and I'm asking you to receive him as you would a brother, on equal footing. And if there is a debt, or if there is, or whatever it is that must be repaid to make things right, Paul utters one of the greatest lines in all of Christian text: charge it to my account. Charge it. I love to say charge it to my account. We all have, most of us have credit cards, and you know it's getting really hard to use checks. Target just this week came out and said they won't take personal checks anymore. And I don't carry a lot of cash, so I'm dependent on that credit card or that bank card, the bank card that is instant debit, to be able to pay my debts, to pay what I owe. And Onesimus owed something. Now, Onesimus had a spiritual debt as well, because see, he had not been a believer. He was a sinner. He was without Christ. And not only did Paul help him take care of his earthly debt, but Paul helped him take care of his spiritual debt. He said to Onesimus, you have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, but charge it to Jesus' account, because Jesus died to pay for your sin debt. You once were lost, but now, upon your believing in Christ, you have been found. So charge it to Jesus' account. You were bound for hell. You were headed to separation from God. But now you have promise of eternity with Christ forever. Charge it to his account. And then he turns around and he says to Philemon, whatever he owes you, charge it to my account. Living out the gospel in such a powerful way, providing a perfect picture of substitutionary atonement in what he did for Onesimus. Now you can imagine Onesimus fearful, ashamed, And the way this letter would have gotten taken back to Philemon would be that Paul would have given it to Onesimus to carry. And Onesimus would have presented it to Philemon when he answers the door of his home. I believe that Onesimus was welcomed with open arms. Because you see, Onesimus and the followers that he was surrounded by, they were a church. And they met in Onesimus's house. So I don't know if we fully understand the impact, because Onesimus was Roman, and we know that Philemon was Roman, and Paul was half Roman, so they were higher status in the culture. Now, I actually don't know if Onesimus was Roman. Let me see if it says. I don't think it says. Actually, upon second thought, I don't know if, I doubt that Onesimus was Roman, because I don't know if he would have fallen to the state of slavery and being Roman at the same time. Because being Roman gave you a foot up in society. And do you remember where Paul started out? He was part of the Sanhedrin, and he persecuted Christians. But then he was on the road to Damascus, and he was confronted by God by a blinding light. And that light had a voice that said, "Paul, Saul," he was Saul before Paul, "why do you persecute me? Why do you persecute me?" And it was there that Saul became a believer, and his life was changed, and his name was changed to Paul, and he became an evangelist, a missionary, a leader in the church. And he took the gospel to the Roman world. Big deal. For him to work in this system, this economic system of slavery, to pay the debt for a slave, would have been really impactful in that society, in that culture. And even for Philemon to have a church in his home was a big deal. I believe that when Onesimus walked back and knocked on that door and Philemon read that letter, that he was welcomed. His debt was wiped away and he was a believer. Welcomed back into the household of Philemon. Now, are we as easily able to forgive? Oh, I want to hang on to mine a little bit, because it feels good for a second to not forgive, to waddle or lay in and enjoy the misery for a minute of not forgiving. But in the long run, not forgiving hurts the non-forgiving person. What I've learned is oftentimes people that hurt us don't even know they've hurt us, and we harbor this not forgiveness, unforgiving spirit, and it just hurts us. And God apparently had a plan for this slave. I would love to know, and I plan to ask when I get to heaven, how in the world, Paul, did you meet up with Onesimus? It was a God thing. Do we recognize the God things when they happen in our lives? I hope we do. Sometimes, just like Onesimus, when we mess up, we run. We want to get away from God. We ghost God. And we want to stop feeling that conviction that we know what we ought to do, feeling. Oh my gosh, that is torment. When you are out of fellowship with God's Spirit as a believer, it's torment. But you can be brought back to right relationship. That's what forgiveness is about. The power of the gospel is that you can be forgiven and forgiven and forgiven, and you can hear that credit card, that spiritual credit card, ding, ding, I'm paying for it. You're okay, Marie. Charge it to my account. Charge it to my account. Charge it to my account. So Philemon was charged with forgiving. Onesimus was charged with forgiving himself. And Paul was the person in the middle that made all this happen. Paul went the extra mile. How can we go the extra mile in bringing reconciliation? How can we advocate for Onesimus in our minds and in our lives? This is just love. Love that we toss around, but at the end of the day, real love really takes effort. What would be the equivalent to writing a letter on Onesimus's behalf today? What, answer me out loud. What would be a modern day example of advocating for an Onesimus? David? Yeah, a letter of recommendation for sure. Helping restore somebody that maybe really needs you to stand up for them in whatever way. Going to a meeting or an advocate with somebody. In a lot of ways, this is what we do in circles when we match allies with circle leaders, to just walk alongside people and give them another set of ears. You know, sometimes when we go to the doctor, it's always good to take another set of ears, because when you're overwhelmed by health issues, you don't hear what you need to hear. So you need an advocate. We all need an advocate. We can be that to each other. Can you think of another example? Yeah. Giving somebody a job, boy, is that hard. For felons particularly, to get a second chance. Finding ways for people to help themselves. Giving mercifully, giving lovingly. Talking to somebody for 3 hours on the phone in love. Mary?
Hiring an attorney for someone who can't afford.
Yeah, oh my gosh, yeah. Exactly, exactly. That's a great point. Thank you. There are so many big and small ways that we can be like Paul was for Onesimus, just vouching and saying, you know, I know that this person used to be a stinker, but I can vouch that Jesus has changed him. And even saying to that person, you know, I'm really seeing a different part of you. I see Jesus in you. I saw certain things before, but now I see Jesus in you. This is a picture of what the gospel can do, and what Paul did going that extra mile. You know, although we should be punished for our sins, Jesus told his heavenly Father to charge it to his account. We can write a letter to God in our hearts with thanksgiving and with rejoicing and with gratitude that our debt has been paid, that we were sinners, separated from God, a huge gulf, because God can't have anything to do with sin, but Jesus, death and burial and resurrection, paid our sin debt. That is just, in the simplest of terms, what we are all about. Put it on my account. Charge it to my... Oh, and for him to physically give money to take care of Onesimus's debt That's just amazing to me. When Jesus said, "It is finished," basically he was saying, "Charge it to my account." Amen? Will you pray with me? God, what a simple message from 25 powerful verses. Lord, we are overwhelmed with gratitude. May we as easily as you did say to those around us, charge it to our account. You don't owe me anything. Charge it to my account. I forgive you. I forgive you. I forgive you. For my spiritual health, I forgive you. Jesus, thank you for doing this work in us. Amen. As we sing above all, one more time, sing it as a prayer, and I'll be standing up here to greet anybody that needs prayer, to join the church, to rededicate your life, whatever you need. Come now as Keith and Eva lead us in above all. you this morning when he felt the nudging of your spirit to say, I need to come and just officially become a part of this body. We love him. We welcome him officially, God. We pray your continued healing in the name and through the blood of Jesus Christ over every square inch of his body and life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Bless you.
We bless you.
Oh, you're welcome.
Yes. Play,
yes, I yes. Why didn't I think of that? That's a great song. Yes.